the coronavirus knows no borders. Similarly, there's one group of people it manages to target more: migrants. They're at a higher risk of acquiring and dying from COVID-19. The data is patchy and the reasons are diverse. Today, we cut through the prejudices and racism to see what's behind the trend.
I'm Ben Fazulin. Welcome to the show. In a moment, we'll talk to a public health scientist about the dangers for migrants. But aside from what the state can do, there's also a lot we can achieve at a community level, as our reporters found out.
As a so-called neighbourhood mother, Mona Ramadan helps recent immigrant women and their families start a new life in Germany. For many, a difficult transition made even harder by the coronavirus pandemic.
People are really worn out, and on top of that, you have the overcrowded housing conditions. At the emergency shelter where I help out, each family lives in one room together. They just need some space. In the beginning of the pandemic, you couldn't even leave the house. Playgrounds were closed. That was a disaster.
Overcrowded housing conditions can lead to a higher risk of getting infected with the coronavirus. Today, Mona Ramadan meets Khadir Al-Saidi, who has lived in the emergency shelter since her arrival from Syria. With the help of the neighborhood mothers, she recently found an apartment for her family.
Of course, there were also many families that were infected. We then helped them to find out where they can go.
Khadir is a single mother. She doesn't have a job yet. Once she has improved her German, she wants to start an apprenticeship. Neighborhood mother Ramadan is helping her. A recent German study has shown that unemployed people have an 84% higher risk of being hospitalized for COVID-19. But similar data for immigrants is lacking. There are empirical studies, for example from the UK and the US, that show that there is a relation between migration and a risk of infection, as well as severe cases. That has little to do with the fact that they are migrants, but with the kind of high-risk jobs migrants disproportionately end up doing. Jobs such as delivering packages or cutting hair, which put workers, often immigrants, at risk of infection. But data connecting health and socioeconomic status is limited in Germany.
Das ist extrem wichtig.
That's extremely important, because this way we can identify groups of people that have a higher risk. And if we also understand why that's the case, we can specifically do something to reduce these risks. While more in-depth data could improve Germany's support structure for migrants, for now, neighborhood mothers like Mona are the best lifeline they have.
Public health scientist and physician Rosa Jahn joins us from the German city of Mannheim. So, should governments be focusing more on migrants in the fight against COVID?
The short answer to that would be yes, absolutely. Migrants are at a higher risk of acquiring and also dying from COVID-19. They're overrepresented among COVID-19 cases as well as deaths, even though it has to be, one has to keep in mind that the data situation isn't great. So there are issues with regards to data availability and comparability of data as well. But overall, we can definitely say that migrants are overrepresented among COVID-19 cases.
Rosa, I've heard that as well from people who work in hospitals saying that COVID wards are full of people with migration backgrounds. I'm a migrant too. Should authorities be targeting me?
I think I would like to make two points with regards to that question. First of all, the reports about COVID-19 wards being over disproportionately filled with patients with a migration background, we don't know. What doctors are experiencing and saying, definitely there is some that's valid, but with regards to actual scientific valid and comparable data. Yes, migrants are more likely to get COVID, But with regards to hospitalization, actually the picture is a little inconsistent. There are some studies that have shown that migrants are more likely to be admitted to a hospital for COVID-19, but there are also studies that show the opposite. So with regards to that, the evidence is a little inconsistent. Nonetheless, the fact that across studies, we do find that migrants are overrepresented among COVID-19 cases. For example, in Sweden, they make up 32% of COVID-19 cases, but only 19% of the overall population. So there's data that points to that. So yes.
What about my situation?
I mean, at a systematic and structural level, we definitely need to improve data availability. We need to be able to more specifically say who is at a higher risk, because migrants are a very large group. And there are some subgroups that have been identified as being particularly at a particularly high risk.
Can you tell us what those subgroups are?
Yeah, of course. One group, for example, undocumented migrants, that they have a hard time accessing healthcare. There's also labor migrants, because they're likely to work in precarious jobs. Healthcare workers also, for example, seasonal agricultural workers. There has been a major outbreak, for example, here in a factory that was processing meat, because labor conditions, as well as, for example, being housed in like labor compounds, all that can increase the risk of being infected with COVID-19. And of course, asylum seekers and refugees who are also living in reception centers where infection, the risk of infection can be high. There's overcrowding. There may be an issue with accessing healthcare. So it's important to look at those differences and then find strategies that target those groups that are at particularly high risk by making sure they're included in vaccination efforts, for example, by making sure that there's appropriate health information available. Those are just two examples, but there's a lot that can be done.
I guess targeting the right migrant group isn't always the easiest, but a refugee camp, how do you go about that? It's easy identifying the people, but there are huge amounts of people living in really cramped quarters.
We've looked at that in a recent review of media reports in Germany to also quantify how high is the risk within those centers, and we've found it to be a 13% risk of the virus spreading after introduction of the first case. And we found that in 75% of those outbreaks, a collective quarantine of the whole facility was implemented. But that this specific measure has actually significantly increased the risk of transmission of the virus within the facility. So instead, we recommend to have more space available to households, reduce the number of individuals living in a facility, make sure that sanitary facilities are not shared, and make sure that health information is available, appropriate health information in different languages is available, and include reception centers in vaccination efforts.
Jose Jan, thank you very much for being on the show today.
You're very welcome. Thank you very much for having me.
And for further reading, the reviews that we referred to there, SARS-CoV-2 among migrants and forcibly displaced populations, and clinical outcomes and risk factors for COVID-19 among migrant populations in high-income countries. Time for Derek Williams and a viewer question about new variants and new vaccines.
Do new variants mean we'll have to create new vaccines, and how long could that process take?
In the news, you hear over and over again that we're at a critical juncture in the pandemic, and the global vaccine campaign is often portrayed as a race against new SARS-CoV-2 variants that could potentially prove resistant to our current battery of vaccines. Variants that are more contagious or more deadly are frightening, of course, but as long as vaccines continue to protect us against them, the race remains a question of logistics. It's all about getting as many people immunized as fast as possible. But another big looming concern that could change that is coronavirus variants that might develop what are called immune escape mutations that would allow them to evade even an immune system primed by vaccines to fight off an infection. Fortunately, this is a situation that health authorities are familiar with, since, for example, they have to update flu vaccines regularly because influenza viruses mutate quickly, a lot faster than coronaviruses do. So experts designing the COVID vaccines approved for emergency use were aware of the danger, and many modern vaccines are relatively easy to update, especially the messenger RNA vaccines. Trials with booster shot versions of them that target specific worrisome SARS-CoV-2 variants are already going on, and approvals are certain to be fast-tracked if red flags start popping up, like if significant numbers of people who are fully vaccinated against COVID-19 suddenly begin showing up in hospitals with severe cases. Long-term, the experts say, future COVID shots might actually combine multiple vaccines that protect against a range of variants, just like today's flu shots often do.
Lastly, the idea of sniffing out COVID is really catching on, especially at airports. Meet Diamond, a German shepherd in training to detect the virus, and Sophie, a Labrador retriever, in this exercise trying to find the one item that belongs to an infected person. The training mirrors that for drug sniffing or search and rescue dogs. Diamond and Sophie are set to start work soon at the airport of El Salvador. Similar programs are in the works in Ecuador and Chile. Thanks for watching. Stay safe and see you again soon.